people have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect.
Subscribe TAG TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.
Hello viewers, welcome to Newsweek South Asia, a program that talks about breeding of terrorism and its impact on South Asian nations. Let's begin with the headlines first. Indian security forces gunned down Alpha Independent Commander, nab his aide. Pakistan's obsession with blasphemy laws leading to extrajudicial killings. And U.S. lawmakers express concern over hasty withdrawal from Afghanistan. In Assam, a movement that started demanding the deportation of the illegal migrants witnessed the birth of militant outfit, the United Liberation Front of Assam, in 1979. Ever since its inception, the ALFA has been a source of continuous violence in the state. The group is involved in various violent activities such as extortion, abduction, murder, and the irony is that such violent activities by this organization mainly affect the common people. Recently, terror outfit Alpha Independent suffered a big jolt after death of its top commander following encounter with Indian security forces. We take a look. Dwipin Saw, the newly appointed commander of the band outfit Alpha Ice Western Command, was shot dead in an exchange of fire in Bongaigaon district of Lower Assam, and another cadre was nabbed alive. Dwipin was appointed after former deputy commander-in-chief Drishti Rajkua surrendered in November. Padum Rai, another outfit member, has been taken into the custody along with two guns, a grenade and several mobile phones. This comes days after the banned outfit abducted three employees of Oil and Natural Gas Corporation in Sivsagar district. Two of them have been rescued since.
I must compliment the security forces for eliminating the ULFA military commander and apprehending one of their gunmen. I must also compliment for them to get the three ONGC, two out of the three ONGC personals released, and we hope for the best for the third one. ULFA, after it was marginalized, certainly is looking for survival. They are also looking for money, and that's why they are into petty crimes of abduction and of extortion. And certainly they need to be kept under check, and I'm happy to see that our security forces are doing an appropriate job to ensure that ULFA is kept under check, and whatever are their remnants, they do not organize themselves in a manner that they pose a big challenge.
Since 1979, the United Liberation Front of Assam has been at the forefront of insurgent violence in the Indian state of Assam. The group, which has been demanding secession from the Union of India, became active in 1982 when it killed a well-known Bengali lawyer, Kalipada Sen. The outfit continued to remain indulged in killing civilians and harassing population through extortion in the name of protection money or business tax from the business houses. The insurgent group is also engaged in conducting recruitment drive in Udalguri and Darang, as well as Tinsukia, Sivsagar and Dibrugarh, the districts which have been their strongholds. But analysis from the security situation in Assam indicates that India's campaign for containing insurgencies in the state has been commendable, as the level of fatalities and insurgency-related violence has come down. Also, many of the insurgents are in peace talks with the government of India, and some of the prominent insurgencies have been neutralized. However, amidst the ongoing peace process, the state has shown signs of renewed insurgent activity in the form of United Liberation Front of Assam, Alpha I, where I stands for independent.
Although ULFA has been marginalized, but the fact that they exist and the fact that they are doing abductions and extortions means that they are in a position to put a law and order problem and to put a challenge of this kind. It also makes them very vulnerable to our adversaries who can lure them to get into more activities and perhaps hope that they will be able to reignite insurgency through them. So that is why I compliment the security forces for killing their commander. I also compliment that they are keeping them very well in check to ensure that this outfit does not reignite insurgency in Assam again.
A highly effective intelligence apparatus to collect timely and actionable intelligence is one of the essential requirements for effective counter-insurgency operations. This has been achieved to a considerable extent of late due to a more professional approach towards collection of intelligence and enhanced public cooperation. However, as long as the Alpha have their bases on foreign soil where Indian security forces cannot enter to destroy them, it is impossible to defeat them decisively. What can be done is to seal their routes of entry and exit. But anyone who is familiar with the topography of the region will realize the complexity of such a task. With the available resources of security forces, foolproof sealing of the border is not practicable. Despite such a drawback, the security forces have done a commendable job, as is evident from the fact that the Alpha no longer has a free run, as was the case in the past. Blasphemy is a highly sensitive issue in deeply conservative Pakistan, where mere allegations have led to extrajudicial killings and mob violence. Human rights campaigners have long sought the repeal of blasphemy laws, arguing they are used to victimize religious minorities or settle personal scores. However, Pakistan has turned blind eye to this discriminatory law. We have a report.
These are the visuals of a mob of enraged Muslims staging a protest outside the civil hospital in Faisalabad district of Pakistan. Members of the crowd were demanding that the two Christian nurses of the hospital, Maryam Lal and Nevish Uruj, be arrested and hanged for committing blasphemy. Muslim colleagues accused the two women of committing blasphemy by removing a sticker that had a Quranic text written on it. Beheading is the only punishment for blasphemer. These were the words of protesters gathered in the emergency department of hospital, and one of them even kicked Maryam Lal as she entered a police van. Moreover, a ward boy in the hospital also confessed to wounding her in a knife attack. Somehow, both the nurses were rescued by policemen. In Pakistan, such false accusations of blasphemy are widespread and often motivated by personal vendettas or religious hatred. Pakistan's religiously discriminatory legislation has contributed to horrible human rights abuses, creating an atmosphere of intolerance for religious minorities that often leads to violence and discrimination. Accusations are highly inflammatory and have the potential to spark mob lynchings, vigilante murders, and mass protests.
As you can see that recently two nurses were targeted in Pakistan and mob, they attacked hospital and they claimed that these nurses have committed blasphemy. Now, these are normally personal vendetta cases where Muslims target non-Muslims, and these nurses are now facing blasphemy cases against them in court of law, and they are behind the bars, and nobody can save the victims of blasphemy law in Pakistan. This is the situation where, for example, if I am a Muslim and I am working in a company and there is a non-Muslim whom I don't like, I can go to police station and I can say that he has done sin by speaking against Prophet Muhammad or Quran. And I don't need any witnesses or anything. My testimony is enough to implicate anyone in Pakistan.
Since Pakistan added Section 295B and 295C to the country's controversial blasphemy laws in 1987, the number of blasphemy accusations have skyrocketed. In February 2021, Center for Social Justice, an NGO based out of Lahore, released data that showed the abuse of blasphemy laws had increased exponentially in Pakistan. According to this advocacy group CSJ, from 1987 to December 2020, at least 1,855 persons have been alleged under the offences related to religion under Pakistan blasphemy laws. One of the most high-profile cases drawing global attention has been that of Asia Bibi, who was handed the death penalty on charges of blasphemy in 2010 and imprisoned until November 2018 when the Supreme Court acquitted her. But not everyone is fortunate. At least 20 people convicted of blasphemy remain on death row in Pakistan. Although no judicial execution for blasphemy has ever occurred in Pakistan, the threat of violence and murder by non-state actors looms large. The Center for Social Justice, in its report, has claimed that at least 75 people have been killed so far in the country on the accusation of blasphemy. Quite frequently, bloodthirsty religious fanatics or radical groups go on killing sprees inside and outside the courtroom, targeting the accused, their families and lawyers, or anyone who may have expressed support for them.
Once you are implicated in reckoning law of blasphemy, then nobody can get justice. Even police people, administration, justice, they cannot change it. If someone, a policeman or a judge, tries to give verdict in favor of the victim of blasphemy, their families are targeted and their lives become in danger. In Pakistan, Governor Punjab Salman Taseer was killed for speaking for Asia Bibi, a victim of blasphemy law. And the sitting governor Punjab was killed in broad daylight in Islamabad by his own guard, and we could not find a Maulvi to perform his final prayers, and that Maulvi that performed his prayers had to flee the country. So this is the situation of blasphemy law in Pakistan.
Pakistan's blasphemy laws violate the rights to life, freedom of thought, conscience and religion or belief, and also freedom of opinion and expression. Although non-Muslims make up only 4% of Pakistan's population, about 50% of the blasphemy cases in the country have been reported against them. Love and affection of the Holy Prophet is such a precious asset that Pakistanis are willing to torture and kill for it, and nothing indicates that they will stop anytime soon.
Let's now move to Afghanistan, where the US-Taliban deal signed in February 2020 is the bedrock of all negotiations around the Afghan conflict. The agreement requires the US to withdraw its military forces from the country, with the United States set to withdraw its troops from Afghanistan before the 20th anniversary of the September 11 terror attacks. US lawmakers have expressed concern over the future of common Afghan people. We take a look.
U.S. President Joe Biden announced on April 14 that the Washington will withdraw all remaining forces from Afghanistan before September 11, 2021. Given the persistent terrorist threats in Afghanistan, there are serious questions about the Biden administration's decisions. Recently, lawmakers of both the parties in U.S. expressed concerns over the future of Afghanistan. U.S. Special Envoy Zalmay Khalilzad testified before the Senate Foreign Relations Committee on U.S. policy in Afghanistan, where lawmakers questioned him about how common Afghan people will be protected if the Taliban takes control after American troops leave the country. Khalilzad echoed President Biden and other administration officials in saying that the U.S. would remain committed to Afghanistan and its development and human rights gains since 2001, despite the withdrawal.
We intend to maintain our embassy and will continue to provide development assistance, promote economic investment, and advocate to preserve the gains for minorities and for women, including their meaningful participation in the ongoing negotiations and their appropriate representation throughout society.
According to a report by the United Nations, the years-long conflict in Afghanistan continues to wreak a shocking and detrimental toll on women and children, who accounted for 43% of all civilian casualties, 30% children and 13% women. This has triggered a sense of resentment among the Afghan citizens at the government's failure to stop a campaign of killing that appears to be aimed at silencing progressive voices of women in the country. There are apprehensions about a possible reversal of progress on women's rights over the last two decades if the Taliban return to any sort of power with the withdrawal of foreign troops from the country. Hence, US lawmakers expressed concern that whether women would be safe if the Taliban becomes strong in the country.
What can you say publicly in terms of what the predictions are in terms of Taliban treatment of women should they take over the government? Again, personally, I'm concerned about public executions and other forms of brutality that will just be so incredibly offensive. And if that's the case, what do we do? Are we going to sit back and just watch that, wring our hands, and mourn the fact that we had made so much progress? And by the way, I think America and allies have to take pride in the progress that was made. I think that's probably our biggest concern here, is having that all that progress be for naught.
Attacks on working women have intensified since the government of Afghanistan began peace negotiations with the Taliban militant group in September 2020. The danger of targeted killings is forcing many women to quit their jobs, being the only option, as they have to remain alive. Observers say that the new US administration should carry out an honest review of the entire peace process and push the Taliban to make consensus. The talks are crucial to find a lasting solution to the Afghan conflict. But it should not be on the Taliban's terms, which could wipe away whatever little progress Afghanistan has made in the last several years. Pakistan has always tried to revive the issue of Khalistan, a separatist movement that is long dead. Through various means and strategies, Islamabad tries to instigate Sikh youth in India and abroad with the objective of spoiling their future. Time and again, Indian security forces have busted terror modules of Sikh separatist group Khalistan Liberation Force and its sympathizers involved in planning target killings and extortions. Recently, NIA filed a charge sheet against 8 terrorists of Khalistan Liberation Force for their involvement in killing Shaurya Chakra awardee Comrade Balwinder Singh Sandhu at the direction of their Pakistan-based handlers. A report.
The National Investigation Agency recently filed a charge sheet against 8 men connected to Pakistan-based proscribed terrorist organization Khalistan Liberation Force for the murder of Shaurya Chakra awardee Comrade Balwinder Singh Sandhu on October 16, 2020. Sandhu, who was conferred with a Bravery Award for fighting against terrorism in Punjab, was gunned down by 2 bike-borne men at his home in Bhikiwin town of Tarantaran district in Punjab. The charge sheet was filed in the NIA Special Court in Mohali, Punjab, against Sukrat Singh, Ravinder Singh, Akashdeep Arora, Jagroop Singh, Sukhdeep Singh, Gurjeet Singh, Inderjeet Singh, and Sukhmeet Pal Singh, among others. The NIA investigation has revealed that the execution of Balwinder Singh Sandhu was carried out with the intention of instilling fear in the minds of Indians, particularly those opposed to Khalistani ideology. The transnational conspiracy was hatched by Pakistan-based self-styled Khalistan Liberation Force Chief Lakhveer Singh Rode and top foreign-based KLF terrorist who provided arms, ammunition and funds to the accused.
Pakistan ki koshish rahi hai, rahegi aur hamesha ye koshish karta rahega. Par aaj hamari suraksha vyavastha, aaj hamari government is baat ko leke puri mazboot hai. Aisi cheezon ko naqab dalne ke liye, inko control karne ke liye, inko tash nash karne ke liye, hamare mein koi kami nahi rahegi. Hindustan ek hai, ek rahega. Inki koi bhi saazish ko hum kamyab nahi hone denge.
The support for Khalistan in India has sunk very low, but the militant groups like the Khalistan Liberation Force and Sikhs for Justice have been pushing their agenda hard through various platforms with the help of the Pakistan's ISI. Moreover, notorious ISI is making every possible attempt to bolster Khalistan groups in different countries across the globe. Recently, a report published by a leading Canadian think tank also reiterated this fact. It said that Pakistan continues to provide training to Khalistani militants and indulges in relentless propaganda on the issue. According to the publication titled Khalistan, a Project of Pakistan, by the MacDonald Laurier Institute, Khalistan movement is a geopolitical project nurtured by Pakistan, threatening the national security of Canadians and Indians. The pro-Khalistan agenda for a separate homeland has no takers in Punjab. But the cause still survives in Pakistan, where jihadist groups have made common cause with Sikh separatists against their shared enemy, India. While several Pakistan ISI chiefs in the past have been vocal supporters of the Khalistan movement, the Pakistani deep state seems to have now embarked on the K2, Kashmir in Khalistan strategy, with newfound hate. The ISI wants to create trouble in both Punjab and Kashmir. A part of this hatred stems from the fact that diplomatically Pakistan has failed to gather any global momentum against India.
Before, it used to be the ISI that used to fund Khalistani terrorists. Now it is usually a Khalistani inclined businessmen abroad who provide funding to the ISI to carry out terror attacks and things like that in India. So that has been a significant shift in pattern. The second pattern that we see is the reinvigoration of those Khalistani ISI links, which again is very worrying.
Indian security agencies have in last several months seen increased activity along the international border in Punjab, with the delivery of drugs and ammunition both increasing, and the use of drones to make such deliveries possible across the border. Agencies have also found that the most prominent Khalistan websites of Sikhs for Justice are being hosted from a server based in Karachi, Pakistan. Khalistani sympathizers based in India are assisting them in amplifying their disinformation campaigns, but because of a strong crackdown on Khalistani forces by Indian agencies and police, Pakistan's fantasy to revive the Khalistan movement is not happening.
And with that, we come to the end of this edition of Newsweek South Asia. We will be back next week with more news, views and analysis from the subcontinent. Meanwhile, do keep writing to us at nwsa@anin.com. This is Yeshi signing off on behalf of the entire production team of Newsweek South Asia. Goodbye and take care.